Now, before moving on to our next session, all those joining us, don't forget you can connect with us through our hashtag E4M webinar. And we'd love to keep this interactive. So please share in your questions and comments. If you're on Zoom, then in the Q&A box. Thank you very much. And now moving on to our next session. Although various industries are affected by coronavirus, this, our industry, amongst them the event and experiential industry, are the most hampered, but it does not stop here, you know. The practitioners have found out a little way to reach their audience, and our next session is going to elaborate on how experiential will shape up in the zero-touch world and future of virtual events. I'm sure all those who are watching us are eagerly waiting for this particular session, because all of us being a part of this very enriching industry are come to this sudden halt, or rather complete stop right now, and all are wondering what to do. And in this conversation, we have with us the stalwarts of the industry, Mr. Roshan Abbas, multi-hyphenated entertainer who, apart from being a radio jockey, theater actor, writer, and director, is the founder of Commune, managing director of Geometry Global and Compass. A very warm welcome to you, sir. Also, we have with us Mr. Brian Tellis, co-founder and group CEO, Fountainhead Marketing. Brian Tellis is an unparalleled pioneer in the events and entertainment industry with a path-breaking career span over 3 years, decades. In 1995, he co-founded Fountainhead Promotions and Events Private Limited. Brian is a founding member of EMA2. They will be in conversation with Dr. Anurag Batra. So I would like Mr. Batra to take it over.
Thank you. You know, I'm really excited about these two gentlemen, because they are multifaceted in the real sense of it. They're entrepreneurs. They are brand accelerators. But let me talk about each of them. I've had the good pleasure of knowing them. Roshan has been a radio jockey. He's been an actor. He's been a stage artist. He's teaching people how to do storytelling. He does a podcast on how to do podcasts. So, you know, they are really multifaceted. Brian, apart from being an entrepreneur and being the experiential marketing industry leader, having set up Fountainhead and then partnered with Dentsu Ages Network, also hosts a radio show, which sometimes I tune in, and he has a voice. Both of them have voice that, you know, makes your heart go fonder, if I may use their really, really talented. So welcome, Roshan. Welcome, Brian. Today we are discussing how the experiential industry will reinvent itself in the contactless times. How will the future of virtual events make up for the loss that we had in the experiential domain? What can each stakeholder do, whether if you're a brand owner, if you're a media owner, if you're an experiential agency, if you're an MC, if you're a vendor? How should you make that shift? And I'd like to start with personal story. I start with Roshan. Roshan, how have been the last 45 odd days for you?
So I keep saying that scaredly, I feel that I might be made for this, because I am a geek. So I love technology. I've been always exploring things. And what I found was that in the first couple of days, of course, there was this whole thing of saying that there's a sense of stasis that enters your life. You seem to be at standstill. And we're in the business of hugs, handshakes, emotions, people meeting up with each other. We thrive when we meet. So suddenly being out, it seemed like a little strange. But then, you know, in the very first week, I also love, I'm curious and I'm a problem solver. So I started saying, how do I solve this problem? So the first thing I did was that I started looking at this whole medium of Zoom and doing a deep dive. There is so much to learn. There is so much to learn on just how you use this interface. Or I realized that I have a mic and I can do a podcast from home. So I started creating a podcast. And, you know, it's a niche medium, but you slowly grow and build a very, very loyal audience on a podcast. I started doing that. I took some of my theater friends and created a play. We are obviously at home. Shaheen and I both have this whole thing of being able to, she cooks, I cook. So we've been doing these little turns on cooking, doing all of that. So it's really, apart from missing out on the human connection of a few friends, I feel that it has brought a lot of efficiency, sometimes over efficiency to the extent that you start feeling, oh my God, am I doing too much? So I just keep telling everyone, take breaks, because I went into hyperdrive. So I've gone into hyperdrive. Now I've gone into cruise control mode, and I have friends like Brian I can chat with occasionally, and we discuss everything from great rock music to, you know, the kind of great shows that he does. You know, whether it's the blues festival and great music, a great life, and of course just living life a lot more fully with a lot more satisfaction.
Fantastic, Roshan. I think that's a very reassuring message for a lot of professionals who've logged in. Who, if Roshan Abbas can reinvent, I'm sure everyone else can reinvent. Because, you know, as he said, he's a very social person, multifaceted, doing gigs. Coming to Brian, Brian's show is called Tell Us As It Is. So, you know, Brian, tell us as it is. How's been the last 45 odd days?
So, you know, I think Roshan kind of, you know, very succinctly evaluated the situation. A couple of differences where I'm concerned. I'm the other extent or the other end of the spectrum when it comes to technology. Also, I get teased about. I'm not too bad, I think, personally. that's the one thing. But I tend to agree with him completely about it's a great time, I think. By default, I am a person who thinks positively, you know, the half full versus the half empty. And I think I have also used this opportunity individually to introspect. It's been a great learning over the last 45 days. You know, to use another proverb, there's no success without challenges, albeit a big one that we're facing at the moment. Hey, you know what? Big challenges might make for big realizations and big changes. And if we can be at the helm of those big changes, that's as exciting to me, you know, as it was being the entrepreneur 25 years ago. That having been said, I think, you know, at this point in time, besides the learnings and the half full, one has to be cognizant of the half empty. One has to be cognizant of the challenges. And you can't lose yourself in positivity. Nor am I recommending that you lose yourself in negativity. I think you need to be balanced in your approach. If you pull out, and let me use the business of experiential, go beyond me into the business we're in, and happily I might add, you know, I believe we are social animals, Anurag. We are social animals. There's no taking away from it. And no one on this earth can predict. I'm certainly not going to try when things will turn around. But having said what I've said, I think we will go back to being the social animals we are by DNA. When that is, like I said, no one knows. Certainly I don't. Now, how do we treat the interim? I think the interim is meant to be a period of learning. Again, we can discuss this further. We often get asked, you know, is experiential going to move to the digital domain? I think the answer is no. Is digital going to play a vital part in our going forward? Of course, the answer is yes. And we can discuss details. So generally speaking, to answer your question, while they are tough times, I think we need to introspect, we need to plan, we need to strategize. And I say this with a happy bent of mind. We need to ready ourselves. And I'm not going to say for the new normal, but we need to ready ourselves for that turnaround point when things do get better in our sense of the term.
Thank you, Brian, for bringing again I love the fact that you said it's a time for learning and being ready when the opportunity comes, when there is, you know, a new way of doing business. So prepare yourself for the future. Have balance. That are your opening remarks. You know, we in business world doing a cover, which is saying from sharing economy to contactless economy, right? Tell us how the experiential industry will morph itself in the new contactless or a zero contact economy. I'm not sure it will become a zero contact, but if the contact points and contact occasions come down, how is the experiential industry looking 3 months, 6 months from now? Right. First you, and then I'll go to Roshan.
Okay, so I firstly want to change the context of the understanding of your question. I want to just go back a couple of steps. While obviously we are at the nucleus of the problem, and the very purpose of what we do is aggregating communities, bringing people together, creating experiences, I want to for a moment just dwell on why we do this. We do this with a large sense of objectivity, whether it's a brand objective, whether it is a societal objective, whether it is, you know, we all know that, you know, if you look at, there are many reasons for us creating experiences. You know, there is, should I say, the faith area where we create festivals like the Kumbh Mela, for instance, just giving you an example. We create events to celebrate life or celebrate champions. You know, the IPL is a case in point. We spread beliefs. We honor talent, you know, award shows and the likes. We launch corporate products. We celebrate times of year and festivals. We also celebrate togetherness in marriages and the like. So there are tons upon tons of reasons why we've become social animals. How is this going to change our lives? Well, I'm not sure it will change our lives too much outside of the interim that we're talking about, right? I don't believe that it will change our lives too much. Like I said, we need to focus on the new elements. Going back to the purpose, if you look at the purpose of why we're in this business, it's to further certain agendas. Now, I'll give you an example of how one can be adapt. One can adapt. You know, recently, last Sunday, actually, we were privileged to be at the heart of, you know, Eye for India, which was a completely digital-driven forum to raise funds, you know, for We Care. And obviously for, you know, for the COVID-19 area. Now, we came together, experiential put it together. We created experiences. We served the purpose, the end purpose that was supposed to have been achieved, while convention would, you know, drive us towards one large meeting at whichever venue. And then whatever, we used an amplification through the various mediums. We chose to actually approach it from an amplification medium, a conventional amplification medium, and made that the driving channel for the purpose of raising funds for COVID-19. Okay, it was a strategic change of focus. The objective was the same, and I think the results, if not were the same, were even better. Okay, so it's a question of adapting and adopting change. We sometimes get stuck in purpose. We create events for purposes. We can still achieve the purpose. We can still, even when things change, maybe there'll be an equal focus on digital and on ground. I'll give you another example of a festival we do in the Blues, as you know, as Roshan mentioned.
The Mahindra Blues Festival.
That's right. Now, the primary focus of the fest, the primary manifestation of the festival is on ground. Happens over 2 days and a weekend in Mehboob Studio, 6,000 people. But over the last 10 years, we've created an online community. For instance, I don't wish to overindulge myself or ourselves, but it has the largest active blues community in the world. It has a radio manifestation which goes out to 5 cities in the country week on week on Sunday evenings. So unfortunately, if it doesn't happen, say the early 2021, we could celebrate it. We could serve its purpose either online plus radio. It may be a manifestation on ground if things don't turn around, a smaller manifestation on ground. As we speak, 6,000 people celebrated on ground. Maybe 200 people will celebrate it live on ground. I don't know. But it will still happen. So my underlying sentiment is that we shouldn't overreact to this. We need to stay on top of the situation. We need to reinvent ourselves. We need to be clear about what the primary focus is on what we do and who we are. And I think, you know, if we actually adopt this method of analysis, I think we'll be a lot happier, we'll be a lot more focused, and I think the results will be evident.
Brian, thank you for really giving a 360-degree view on why you believe that digital will be an integral part of experiential, but at some stage, experiential on-ground events, keeping the hygiene and sanitation in mind, will be back. And hopefully, in September, October, if not definitely early next year. Roshan, what do professionals, brand managers, media owners, you know, media creates IPRs, experiential agency owners, SMEs that use events to bring along their dealers, event management professionals, give us something for them to reinvent themselves? Because you reinvented yourself multiple times. And kept all the good parts and kept adding layers. So how do people add layers? How do professionals add the skills that Brian talked of a little bit before?
So I keep telling people that Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy is one of my favorite books. And it opens with a man sitting in a house and suddenly outside there is an alien with this tractor beam and a huge spaceship. He says, "I'm sorry, but I've got to destroy the Earth because you're standing in the way of a highway that needs to be made in the galaxy. And he's like, what do you mean? And suddenly he's on this journey across a universe he has never been in. And he has only two things with him, a book and a towel. And it says, don't panic. So the first thing that I tell people is, this is going to be a new universe that many people are entering. Many people, digital used to look at physical and say, we don't do that. Physical used to look at digital and say, we don't understand that. But there will be a brand new world that will emerge. So the first thing I often say is that don't panic, take a pause and first look around you and say, what are you in the business of? See, very often we forget, we just say, oh, we've got to put money here, we've got to put money there. What are you in the business of? Are you, when we do work, we often turn and say, the other day we were doing an event for HP, which had 7,000 people online with us in a Zoom, because you can take Zoom and make it much bigger. And there was about 10 lakh people who viewed it over a period of 2-3 days. At the time, during the course of the event, 70,000 people. Now, what was the purpose? The purpose was, it was called the Spirit of HP, and we had to engage with the entire community of their partners, with their employees. So we decided on what the messaging is going to be, and you can then work on that purpose by using, just like we used to use everything from song, music, light, etc. at our events, there is a translation of all of those online. Right now we have X number of participants, people who are attendees. We engage with them by doing polls, by doing Q&A, by playing things, by doing things. So again, I'm saying, let creators and technologists, every brand should get a bunch of creators and some technologists together and say, play. Here is a little bit of things play. I remember Punita at Pepsi at one point in time when digital had just started, used to tell me, saying, Roshan, I don't want to back one idea. I want to put a little bit of money behind 10 ideas. I'll see which of them works and then I will go after it. So this is the time to sow 100 new seeds. This is the time to incubate or innovate. Do one of the two things, because that is critical. Don't get into this mode of, I'm not going to do anything, I'll keep my money till things will come back. Brands that do nothing at this time will start losing relevance because someone else will use this medium a little better. The other thing is that in the live industry, people know that there are, I think at the last estimate when EMA did one whole comparison, they said that over 400 million people indirectly get impacted by what we do. It's hospitality, it's travel, it's food, it's entertainment, it's the entire live industry. Everyone gets impacted. But so many people getting impacted are not going to sit. They're all going to come and do something. I read a beautiful thing yesterday where a Dutch restaurant has set up these cabins near the waterside. And three people can enter at one time. It's totally sanitized. You can go in, sit by yourself. It's sanitized before you go in, it's sanitized later. Believe it or not, they are booked out for the next 1 month. Because somebody has solved for the fear. Somebody has solved for the sanitization. So people are already doing that. We would have all seen videos of planes being sanitized by these machines, places. So innovation is key. This is the time to go and incubate 10 small ideas that may not even be from your domain, but you can do them. To give you an example, we have this division which we set up actually in the last 2 months called Prodigy. And people said, are you just starting up another digital agency? And we said, no, we are setting up a human experience agency for the digital world. Because we need to keep creating that emotional context. We need to be finding ways of translating human emotions across a screen. That's what great content does. So we said, we'll do that. We did a song for a brand online by getting people together. We did these mega concerts. We even did a play. We used this Zoom technology. We repurposed a storyline, which was about blind dates, to being online dates. And now it's a product that brands are buying because we have created something that gets eyeballs. The relevant eyeballs are of a younger generation that is a lot more akin to technology and understands technology. And then a brand will say, where the consumer is, the brand will follow. So one other advice that I want to give people is invest in creating your own digital communities. You have a community of marketeers, a community of business owners, a community of brands that come to you here, which is why you're relevant. But build the digital avatars of that. For too long, we have ignored the digital avatars of the physical work we do. It is really time to think of the digital avatar and think of it in a million different ways. Concerts have happened online, but right now, people have not worked enough, I feel personally, on the experience agenda. And that's what we will bring as a change.
I want to add to what...
Sure, Bharat, right.
I want to add to what Roshan said. While I completely confirm with what he has said.
This happens to Brian in every webinar. So it's
I know that.
It's a good omen. It's a good omen.
And it'll always be an urgent call.
For our viewers and leaders who were logged in, the reason we took Brian and Roshan, we wanted two good-looking men and one clean-shaven who's making sure the Gillette stock price is moving up and one who's making sure that, you know, other grooming products for beards.
Beardo is working.
Yeah, he's using Beardo. So, yes, Brian.
Sorry. Yeah, so, you know, I started to say I concur, except for the Beardo bit. No, actually, I do on the Beardo bit as well, Roshan. With what Roshan said, I just want to add that, you know, people generalize about digital. Like Roshan's talking about Prodigy, we at Fountainhead are working and we used a fair bit of it in the last, you know, I for India, where we have experientialized our technology in digital. We're creating a separate brand called Merge, which, as the term suggests, will hopefully merge what are our principal mediums of engagement, which is live experiences with technologically driven experiences. I mean, I think the writing's on the wall as far as that is concerned, and I might add happily so. We need to really embrace this change and use it to our advantage. Again, Roshan mentioned, and I want to validate that this is time for, you know, they say when the going gets tough, the tough need to get going, you know, and I think this is a boys to men kind of time when we need to kind of introspect, like I said, and actually grab the opportunity by the what you call it and take it forward. I think there's tons to be gained. Sorry, I just needed to validate what Roshan...
No, I agree. And I'm just going to add one more point, Anurag. Sorry, with your permission.
Your show, so please.
No. The other thing is that I keep, you know, people again keep telling and saying that, this thing about technology and creators, you keep saying. I said, guys, every time there has been a seismic shift in media, it has been because of this. When radio gave way to television, Anurag, I can tell you, and I always love the story, that the first couple of radio presenters who went to television just put a desk and sat behind it and spoke because they knew no better. But when they bought theater people and said, we've got these cameras, we've got a studio, what do they do? The sitcom happened. And if you remember in the early days, they used to have a live audience sitting because the theater people used their mind and said, we need a live audience.
Yeah, the first one was not a stock show, but Saab CD.
Right. And India, I'm saying that the early bunch of shows that happened here, and so many
That's
of
how
these,
you added interactivity.
And interactivity, this platform is ripe for engagement. You can do everything from a game show to a meditation. I have seen the craziest of things. I've seen people doing meditations online right now. I've seen podcasting go up because people are sometimes sick of a visual medium, so they want only audio. You know, and Spotify is working on that and developing that. And today I was asked saying, how many people can you take in your workshop? And I said, we have a 500 people Zoom webinar. I said, but how many have registered? They said 800 people have registered. Now imagine 800 people want to make new age content using their phone for a medium that's just come. That is great news because this generation is a DIY generation. They want to do these things. When a Diageo turns around and says, you know what, I'll stop and I'll start making hand sanitizer. When you have an Asian Paints has launched an entire range, I was told that they are, you know, getting in, they're saying this is just one more surface. We need to be able to find. So go back to the core of what you do.
Yeah.
Why is a brand not doing classes for us to groom at home right now? I gave myself a haircut. You can see the results are... I don't know whether they're scary because Brian looked at me 2 days back and said, what happened?
Yeah.
Like, I said, you know, I came from the gym up in upstairs in the house and I came down, I was feeling really warm and I'm like, let's use the clipper.
I'm just glad you didn't say it's the new normal, Rosh.
No. So, you know, so the whole thing is that there are so many missed opportunities and that pains me that brands are right now saying, I'll hold back for quarter 3, quarter 4. you know, this is a time for relevance or revenue. There are opportunities for both. People need to find it. And, you know, when you said that from the sharing economy, we're going to the, you know, no touch
contactless.
Or whatever. I'll tell you, you know, Anurag, I'll give you a better headline. From sharing to the caring economy.
I love that.
We are really going to the caring economy, Anurag. Look at what's happening. In my podcast, I was talking to restaurateurs and saying, how will you survive? They said, forget about us. How will the person on the road survive? A person who is our dear friend, Brian and me, Rahul Gomes, has just gone and, you know, went and took a whole bunch of vendors and created a hospital, because that's what is needed, using event vendors and event suppliers, right? The dome was created into a hospital because I think people are going out and caring. How many people have gone and made a donation? Brian's, I was amazed. Eye for India, I mean, that number, what was it, 57 crores?
Yes, and counting.
And counting. Look at that. So we are becoming a caring economy. We suddenly care for our neighbor. We care for the man on the street. We care for the migrant labor. So this is the time for the caring economy to come.
Also, one beautiful. More. Sorry, one more. Right. You know, sorry, Anurag, I hope I'm not, we are not.
No, disturbing you, perfect.
It's no, I'll tell you, over the last few days, maybe weeks, I don't know, there have been a lot of questions that we've asked ourselves, that people have asked us, we've asked people. Every one of us can't be everything to everyone. Okay. I suppose what I'm starting to say, if you haven't already been of a collaborative nature, then now's the time to embrace collaborative nature. Okay. We sometimes make the primary mistake and a fatal mistake sometimes of me trying to be who Roshan is or vice versa. You don't need to do that. Rest secure in who you are. Understand your, do a SWOT, understand who you are, understand where your strengths are. Like I said, you don't have to be everything to everyone. Figure out someone who can help you, who can ally with you. Don't be afraid to share the spoils, because in the process of collaborating, you're increasing the size of the pie. So I just want to propagate at this time. You do not need to become a digital expert. You do not.
You just gave me a headline for my next Business World cover.
I'll charge you 15%. I learned this from Anurag Batra.
No problem. But on a very serious note, it was called the contactless economy. And you've just given me another 3C economy: collaborative, caring, and contactless.
There you go.
Beautiful.
There you go. And it is collaborative. You know, I truly, firmly believe that. Don't try to be everything to everyone. And it's worked for us as well. Again, an example maybe is necessary to prove my point. About 2.5-3 weeks ago, you know, we were approached to do a global conference. And a global conference with a stage, a live stage, with live performances. And it's not about recording the performance. It was live performances, live speeches, a live panel discussion. Now, we found a country. It turned out to be a city, Stockholm, which is, for obvious reasons, allows for a little bit of luxury in today's day and age. We actually got partners there to build a stage in a large place, build a wonderful stage. We got an actual live host. And with backdrops, with audio visuals and everything, we controlled it out of Sweden with our partners. We had performers from different parts of the world. We actually had a band perform. We actually had speakers from various parts of the world. Now, all of this calls for collaborative effort. We may have been the pivot. We may have driven certain areas. Even in Eye for India, it was a collaborative effort. So I want to just drive home the point and drive it home really emphatically today for all the right reasons, that all of us have different strengths. Even as we speak in the conventional experiential industry, some of us are known for a certain something. Some of us are known for being expert wedding, agencies. Some of us are known to be way more corporate agencies. Some of us are known to be theater propagating. I mean, I'm saying we all have our strengths and we build. So build on your strengths. Learn in the process. Do not be bashful about collaborating, and you'll be amazed at the results where the pie will grow. Yes, it might take for you to share the spoils at this point in time, but I mean, we've been there. I'm not saying anything new or earth-shattering.
Anurag, there is
and then, question. You know, Roshan said something so beautiful. I've been talking to lots of MDs, very large owners of businesses, brand managers, media heads. And, you know, Roshan said something that this is a time to be relevant and revenue will also happen. I think brands that have taken a pause should take note of what Roshan has said. It's just that you repurpose the way you kind of reach out.
Absolutely, absolutely.
Roshan, yes.
Yeah, there's a question that Rohit Mohan has asked saying experiential has been key in lead generation activities offline. How do you think the same will now be done online? So, you know, I'll tell you one thing, Rohit. It's an amazing thing that these metrics that we always used to hear of, which was reach, engagement, views, right? I mean, whenever somebody talks of digital, this is what they talk of. In live events, very often we didn't look at these metrics. We were just happy keeping people happy. Whether it was the audience or whether sometimes it was a brand, I'll be very honest, sometimes you're fulfilling one wish list, sometimes you're fulfilling another. But now, this metric of reach, engagement, views, this how many people, I can tell you the number of people who have gone and clicked on the Anchor app due to my pitch fest for podcasting. I have 25,600 and some people who have gone there. I have got over 800 entries. So this is lead generation. Lead generation on digital is far more quantifiable, far more easier to do. But are you taking a human action, an experiential action to get the person to take part? That's what sometimes people miss. I find a lot of digital has also gone and become, and pardon my saying this, I am part of Glitch and I think that they work so hard because they put on the same hats. They think like youngsters and say, would I react to that? And they'll give the campaign to 10 people and who will say, no, this is really not worth it. But you know, with Prodigy, what we are doing is we are constantly turning and saying, so what's the human action that I want? I want people to, at this point, do the following, click the following, sense the following, share the following. That's what we used to do at events. You would hug someone, you would clap with someone, you would laugh, you'd do all of these things. And later people started using technology. Beacon technology was being used to see how many people aggregated around a booth, right? Heat sensors were being used. GPS mapping with space was being done to actually estimate how many people attended a rally or how many people attended a live concert, because people used to give numbers which are fictional very often. There is a lot more measurement. There is a lot more quantifiable things that you can do using the power of experiential with the measurability of digital. So I think that's possible.
Roshan, let's give one more idea to Anurag where we can maybe take 15% each.
Hanna, yeah, he's just
using alliteration. So
I'm actually taking note. I swear I'm actually taking note. I'm not kidding.
So here's one
I'm
more.
I'm actually taking notes.
So the next seminar for which we'll take 10% each is reach, relevance, and resurgence of revenue. Anurag, 10% each, okay? That's the deal. We've got a fair amount of people listening and they are, you know.
You know, you solved my one problem today, Brian. I always, when I was preparing for this and Priyanka called me, and I said I'd love to chat up with them because, you know, they're really, you know, they're entrepreneurs, they're multifaceted, they're experiential leaders. So, you know, I know them well and, you know, it'd be fun to talk to them. I was confused when I grow up, I want to be like Brian Tellis or should I be like Roshan Abbas? But now I know I can be a Roshan Tellis, I can be a Brian Abbas. There can be a collaboration. So I think I'm very happy.
Anurag, don't forget, I mean, there was a film called Amar Akbar Anthony.
Absolutely.
Were you going to say that, Brian?
Absolutely.
My God.
I was just going to say that. You took the words out of my mouth.
So we've got, you know, Amar Akbar Anthony, Anurag, Roshan, Brian.
Yeah, exactly.
Beautiful.
I want to tell you. See, look at what's happening interestingly, Anurag, right? In the chat, we talked of data. One person said, I have a database of so many. One person said, I want a database. There's already a connection that's been made. You know, now you will have one more person who will turn and say, I could validate that data for you. And we will come on top of that and say, I'll tell you what, you might have the data, but getting that data to engage with you is what we will show you. And that is it. Engagement is what people need to learn. You know, live is one of the most difficult things to create engagement because people have seen everything, they've done everything. And each time we will conjure up something from our hats and do something which is unique. I remember with Amit Singhal every year at Asian Paints, when we used to do a conference, he used to turn to us and say, what will you do next year? And we would come up with something new because, you know, this whole idea of almost being a magician, which brings, you know, some amount of emotional relevance is what we used to do. And I think that magic can be recreated on digital now that we have put our minds to it. Really, really great technologies, great people in data, great people in creative should all come together. This is a laboratory environment and we will get together and beat it.
Fantastic. You know, I'm so happy. I've done lots of webinars throughout the week. And I can say for me, it is one of the most interesting today has been. Before you, I spoke with Rahul Agarwal of Lenovo. He was so real as a business leader, so real and so specific. And this is so much specific and fun. And a full of new ideas. We'll take questions beyond 2 p.m. We have lots of questions. But I want to ask you two questions. One is if the marketing spends in the next 3 months, and I'm taking a 3-6 month horizon, will come down. They've already come down. How much will experiential come down? Because it's a subset of marketing.
Brian, you want to take that? You want me to take that?
We can both give our points of view, but... I'm hazarding a guess at best, Anurag, because no one knows what's going to happen. The level of uncertainty is really, really high. But obviously, we are mapping. It's a perspective. This is a perspective and it is subjective to the nature of your business, to the nature of your beast. Even within experiential, there are some, you know, areas of commerce or industry that will be affected a lot more than other areas, right? I mean, if you're working... If a lot of your work, for instance, is with retail people, that's come to a grinding halt as well, for obvious reasons. If it's manufacturing
activation.
As well. Yeah,
if it is activation at retail that's point, right. then that's right. hugely impacted.
Correct. So it's different strokes for different folks at this point in time. But if you're asking me to generalize on how much it'll affect by way of percentage points, we've done a bit of introspection as far as we're concerned. And we see it. This point in time, obviously, it's a number that will keep changing, hopefully going down. But we believe that the percentage that it will go south is around 35%. To try and give you a direct answer.
Saying 75, that's a very large number.
Saying it will drop by 35%.
So it will stay 65%.
So the first time where I will actually disagree.
Yeah.
Because I really feel that we have to be a little, Q1 was fine for most of us. If this is an annualized number that Brian is giving, maybe it I is. Would still, annualized. Because Q2 is next to zero for most people. People are willing to let you experiment, but we are now getting to the stage of getting them to pay for it. Remember, what used to cost 1 crore to do on ground is costing 10 lakhs to do online. And that's where the problem is starting, because if you have people who cost you the amount that those outputs justified, there are a lot of very harsh decisions that are going to be around the corner. I don't think anyone has a runway as an agency, etc., to manage things for more than 3 months. And I don't think it is even prudent business to do that. We are all being as caring as we can. But really, Q2 is a write-off. I think Q3 will also be a write-off. People who will repurpose themselves may be able to get some revenue. And therefore, we move most of the... Thankfully, we have a lot of fees that are paid to us because we have a shopper marketing division. And that and planning gives us some fees. Creative and content will be paid for. But what will you do if you don't do a physical production and there is no light, no sound, no set, no stage, whatever? Talent is now available for at least a 50% off because people are saying, hey, you're at home. The live engagement is not happening. A great comedian friend of mine told me that, he said, I've realized that they paid 20 rupees out of 100 for me and 80 for everything else. So unless I can recreate that 80, the value at that core is 20. And therefore, many people are refusing to do things because they do not want to compromise on maybe the halo they've built or what they've built otherwise. So I genuinely feel that Q2, Q3 are write-offs. The EMA report has said that the impact to the industry in the first 2 months was about 3,000 to 5,000 crores was to the event industry in 2 months. the overall impact over time, Sanjoy said, is about a trillion over time, because it's not coming back so easy. And when people say, when will this end? I'm sorry, I've been very optimistic about most things, but this one, I don't see before a spring 2021 things to go back to a thing, because it's so vaccine dependent, because fear will keep people away from physical expression. It will be the same with going out and seeing films. It's the same that will happen with eating out. And I've been in my podcast, I've been talking to these industries, so I can tell you it's very grim.
Okay, so Roshan, I just want to double check. When you say, when I said, when you talk about annualized percentage that it will drop, are you talking the financial year? Are you talking April to March 21? Are you talking...
So we have a Jan to December cycle. Therefore, therefore, I'm saying that these two quarters are almost... I mean, even in prediction, Q3, people are making predictions. But, you know, I've actually been turning and saying that let's be realistic and see what can be done in Q4. And whatever revenue you can do will have to be from these lines of work.
Right.
And those are 10 to 20%, Brian, of what we all do overall, right?
No, so let me actually throw some light on this or help get some light from you for the benefit, of course, of our viewers, listeners. So, you know, I think it's a no-brainer that in our business, let's take the calendar year for discussion. The first quarter, Jan to March, has been, I think, the second best quarter of the year for most people, if not all people. And the fourth quarter, which is, you know, October, November, December, is the best quarter, given the nature of our beast. Okay. So, I think the upside is that the first quarter, Jan to March, has been, well, I'd say relatively unaffected by this.
Correct. Yeah, we did our numbers for Q1. Yeah.
So that stays the course. Okay. The fourth quarter, October to December, is when we are hoping, and I'm hoping that our hope is based on what will happen rather than what won't. There'll be a sense of normalcy that will be restored. A sense of normalcy. I'm not saying it'll happen like we projected at the beginning of the year. The middle two quarters, you know, which is pretty much April through to September, have in any case in our business been low quarters. When you look at the macro, they have been lower quarters. So in that sense, two things have happened. One is it gives us, if you're working the calendar year, it gives you gave us 9 months. Even as we speak, it gives us about 6 to 7 months. If not 8, to kind of do what we have to do, whether it is adding revenue or whether it is dropping costs and creating cost efficiencies. So keeping all of that in mind is me projecting what I am.
Okay. There's a whole bunch of questions, Anurag, which have started coming. So whenever you want to, want to take them.
I want to ask you one question. See, while you're experiential experts, you're talk show hosts, you're entrepreneurs. What is your advice to entrepreneurs in any segment, of course, in the ad tech space, experiential space, martech space, that's the space Exchange for Media Pitch Impact. What's your advice to entrepreneurs? First Roshan and then Brian.
So you know, I keep saying that there are hardworking and hardly working. You know, that's the division right now.
And can you give us examples?
Right. So see, what happens is that digital is really hardworking at the moment because there's so much to do.
Sure.
So that's one space. Essential services, hardworking. But restaurants, entertainment, theater, movies, all of these as areas are hardly working. So firstly, what I keep telling people is look at the hardworking sectors and see, is there an opportunity to partner? Is there an opportunity to collaborate? Or is there, if you are an entrepreneur who has saved up money, an opportunity to invest? Because there will be a lot of gaps that will emerge that you will fulfill. For example, textile manufacturers are suddenly making masks because there's a need gap they've discovered. Making PPE, I've had at least 7 friends who are running factories of different things contacted me saying, hey, we are doing now PPE production. So they are identify need gaps and address them. This is a great time to, you know, when people go every year annually, they used to do this health check. This is a great time to do a reality check and a health check on your business. Many people run vanity businesses for the longest time. A lot of media establishments are realizing that they were running vanity businesses that were dependent on just a few advertisers. Now, if that's not happening, look at the slew of shutdowns. Embrace it. swallow it, it happens. You all are great entrepreneurs, you can restart. But embrace it. Don't shut your eyes to it, because I think many mediums will realize that they are not as relevant as other mediums were. And so start, I keep going back, work on your relevance, the revenue will follow. This is the time to hunker down, collaborate, learn new things, cut out costs. So for example, if there are any common costs as entrepreneurs that you feel you and five other businesses have, combine that together so that you can bring that cost down. B, this is a very important time to reach out to the government and actually pressure them to say, we are the ones who fill your coffers every year. We are tax-paying businesses. We need your support. And I really feel that it is important for that lobbying to happen and for people to... I don't know who are the right people to lobby, but I think Brian and I often keep searching for who will do it for us. But, you know, because we are there. We are making everything from your religious function to your home celebration to your corporate celebration to your connection and your emotive connection to your audience happen. But suddenly when this happens, the first people to be ignored are... So again, I'm becoming a little more personal looking for the businesses. But as entrepreneurs, these are a few of the things that I think people should do.
Brian?
Yeah, I think, you know, I don't want to sound repetitive. Roshan has, you know, gone through some of the key points. I just want to dwell, while Roshan has dwelt and dwelt quite cleverly and rightly on the revenue side and how one must react, I just want to dwell on the cost side, because, you know, money saved is money earned, you know, and as an entrepreneur, you're supposed to draw the balance between the two, cleverly draw a balance between the two. We know where the challenges are at the moment. So one needs to focus on both sides, increasing revenue or protecting revenue, as also rationalizing costs. And I'll tell you one of the challenges that we face. We face accepting and embracing reality. Okay. We sometimes tend to live in a fool's world. That's a bit of a harsh statement I'm making, but I'm making it very deliberate.
Completely agree.
You know, and we need to take that long, hard, proverbial look in the mirror and actually draw a line differentiating who I am as a person and who I am as an entrepreneur. I must retain my emotions as a person to the best I can, but it cannot be detrimental to the expectations from me as an entrepreneur. I know, and we all say this over and over again and mean it hopefully every time we say it, that our, in the services business that we're in, our key assets are our people. And that's absolutely right. Now, having said that, and having embraced that sentiment, we are also in a position as entrepreneurs, and the expectation is none less than keeping the business profitably alive and well. Now, there are going to be moments when the person in you debates the professional in you, or the professional in you debates the person in you. I think one of the key challenges for entrepreneurs is to draw a fair balance, keeping all of the ecosystem in mind, being absolutely honest and true, not just to yourself, but to the business and to your KRAs and to the expectation that whether it's the investors or whether, you know, the rules of entrepreneurship demand from you to make prudent and the clinically right decision as well. You can do it with empathy. I always say, you know, you can go into a boss's cabin after having done something wrong, and there are two mindsets you can come out with. And I had the privilege once many years ago of being absolutely dressed down by my British manager at that time when I was in the airline business. But I'll tell you, he didn't hold back. He told me exactly where I had messed up. He told me exactly what, you know, I was expected to do and what I didn't do. But, you know, the difference was I walked out of that cabin with my self-belief and my dignity intact. And I think you can make some of the hardest decisions, but you can do it in a few ways. Some ways are disastrous ways. But if you are prudent, if you retain dignity, if you retain integrity in your communication, I think you can make hard decisions and in fact make them work for you. Because I think at this point in time, people understand that the environment demands certain things from us. So I do believe, to answer, just come down to the meat of the matter of your question, Anurag. The one thing that we need to do as entrepreneurs is to make the right decision for the business as well. At this point in time, sustainability, cash flows are the key words, and not for the wrong reasons, for the right reasons. So there will be prudence in spend. That's where innovation comes in. So it's not just about revenues and protecting revenues or increasing revenues. It's also a, it's also about creating efficiencies in operation and hence efficiencies in cost.
Thank you. I want to bring in the audience, and I'll keep my last two, three questions for the end. There is Tanya Grover asking, does the normal BTL activation make sense in the next 6 months, in the coming 6 months? So she's possibly asking, will BTL activation be back in the next few months? Roshan and then Brian.
For essential services, yes, we've done activation.
Define essential services.
So see, for example, when we've been doing work for a couple of brands which have got elements like sanitization, etc., as part of their portfolio, we've been able to go out and do that. I think e-commerce will also at some stage start doing some amount of activation. Frankly, they may not need it because they are already so much in demand and they are fighting a different battle where they want to get other things delivered apart from non-essential, because there is a strange phenomenon that happens when you've been kept down so long. Everybody is looking for that guilty pleasure to indulge in the minute descends. So people, I can tell you, I've heard conversations saying, you know, I'm going to do that one bag, I'm going to buy one holiday, one whiskey, one food. So people are waiting, but what happens is that it's up to the government to decide what they will open when. And that's where the problem is right now, that even if we want to follow the norms and do it, will the powers that be allow it? So I don't see it happening for things beyond non-essential. And again, essential and non-essential is what our world has become divided into, as somebody rightly said. That's
so
what
Tanya Grover has asked, will activations be back in the next 3 months?
What kind of activation? So see, Tanya, sure. I'll give you an example. Activations, mostly the July used to be the back to school, back to college activations, right? Now what will happen? Classes will start online, the activation will move online. And you can make it happen online. The same activation that you did, we did a huge thing for Amazon Prime last year, which was where we actually made them buy from a virtual shopping mall. The design was brilliant. It was being done by using AR headsets. Now, I will not have the AR headsets, but I will create the website online. I will find ways of entering your feed with maybe influencers and other people saying, oh my God, I just went to this website and I bought this. Will you try it as well? It's the same formula. Just find its expression for digital. And if you don't have that, then you're in trouble because physical activations are still away. What will physical activations happen around? The government may employ some people to educate people on saying, this is what you need to do. This is how you need to stand in a line. This is how you need to buy stuff. All this will happen. But how many agencies will get that job? I don't know. And where will that work come from? I don't know. So that's my
Brian.
I want to add, as always, Roshan has thrown some really wonderful light on it. But I just want to add that while we look at the situation we are facing, I think marketers' point of view, the marketers' point of view is, there's already activity, in fact, in the B2B space, okay, which might not happen across the table, but there's already action happening in the
lot of e-demos.
That's right. And B2B, so I'm saying not just B2B, but even internal. So a lot of brands are looking at this time like we are, of introspecting, of internal training, of internal education, of knowledge aggregation, of all of these things. So these are areas that one must use at this point in time. Like we go back to the basics. What is it, when we think of in normal circumstances, what does a brand or a company want to do? We need to now look at extraordinary circumstances. And what do brands and marketing custodians want to do for brands? Basically, one of the key areas is they want to do internal training, internal knowledge aggregation. So they're doing internal training.
Add new skills, possibly digital, absolutely. Possibly storytelling.
Absolutely. I'm dealing with, that sounds negative. We are actually talking about three, maybe four of our brands who now want to use this time on digital training. Get in experts. You're still, the formula doesn't change, as Roshan said. It's the engagement medium that changes. For better or for worse is subjective. So we've already got three brands that are talking to us on how can they strengthen the internal teams by way of information, by way of formal training, by way of informal training, by way of, you know, unfortunately in our regular work day, we don't get the luxury of talking to each other, exchanging knowledge, even within an organization. We are so busy running around chasing our tail. I'm not saying that's necessarily a bad thing. Companies have realized that it's time to actually bring their teams together through engagement and through communication. That's the one area. Then there is the B2B2C as well.
There is a similar question from Anuva Badja. Hello, yeah. I'm from Event Management Company, corporate only. So my question is, how we will plan or from where we can start to do any kind of activation? I think it's kind of answered already.
Yeah. So can we go to the pile is saying,
digital is the medium for communicating, but do people have money to spend? The priority has changed completely. How do you tackle this? So will digital make money?
I mean, people always have money to spend. It's a matter of how convincing is your pitch. I'll give you multiple examples here. Many people do the following. So, for example, are you in a position, Payal, right now to actually offer them a demo of your digital service and show them the result? Are you able to ask them to pay basis performance? That's what digital has been doing all along. There is so much performance marketing which is involved in digital campaigns. When a YouTube salesperson goes or a person goes from an Instagram, they talk numbers. When big platforms go, they talk numbers. If you talk numbers and you talk action that a brand needs, people will buy. Please, if you haven't, there are so many lovely books to read. And, you know, David Gilvey's book often talks of the whole thing of saying creating, you know, the salesman who sold you the AGA stove. There are so many things that people are still looking for. We are all excited about. That excitement translates to sale. For example, as Brian said, learning is a great focus. Content is a great focus. I can say with guarantee that when you open your YouTube, the first ad that is playing is Netflix. Because they have made sure that they are going after that market right now because they figured content is one relevant area. Education is one relevant area. There is this e-services area, which is also happening. So these are places to go for if you want to look for brands that are looking for activation. But remember, everyone is going to them. So do you have great ideas?
Yeah. To continue from where Roshan left off, Roshan has very cleverly spoken about what one can do, Payal, to get your product right, to get your offering right, you know, offer proof of concept, which will convince the client. I'll add to that. Have we actually spent enough time? I don't want to use the word researching, but finding out what the client or the brand actually needs at this point in time. Roshan mentioned.
Get deeper into that.
That's right. Can we do that? Can we actually, are we clever enough? Like Netflix. Netflix knows that with people sitting at home all over the world, one of the big things they can do is actually watch Netflix. So it's actually figuring out what the brand, whichever brand your company deals with, Payal, figure out at which stage of its life cycle the brand is. What does it need to communicate, especially at a time like this? How relevant can that communication be to its ecosystem and actually make an offering beyond what Roshan said and beyond? So there has to be a product that can deliver, but deliver on what? Deliver on a promise. Deliver, you know, on a concept. What is that concept? That concept or that promise has to be based on what the brand needs. It can't be what you think will work in the market. It has to be what the brand thinks will help it in its life cycle and in its growth. Sometimes we make the mistake of dwelling too much on our expertise. It's about how can we apply our expertise to what the brand needs. They are the ones spending the money. We make that mistake very often of propagating who we are and what we do, which is a good thing, but we need to understand that who we are and what we do has to marry a need in the market, whether it's a brand need or a community need. So spend a little time introspecting and applying what you do best to what is required, and you will have a formula.
There is Shruti Chitari. Considering the current scenario, is the event industry going completely digital post-COVID? Brian has already answered that it digital will become bigger, but experiential in the core way does will stay. And Roshan answered it. It's how you define businesses. You're in the business of creating experiences. Now, some of those experiences will get created using digital. Harish Daulat Singh, I am an event management agency catering to the real estate sector. I would appreciate few ideas to help my clients reach out to prospective buyers or channel partners. There is Ashok Agarwal. How do you see event execution? What makes a event good COVID compliant event?
So can I answer those two? Can I answer one or two of those? Okay. Yes. So one thing about the gentleman who asked about real estate, I think that's a sector where right now everybody is looking. See, buyers have money. I don't think it's that buyers don't have money, but the buyer for some amount of real estate definitely has money. What do they need right now? Either they need a never before, never again, right? I often say that in the festival experiences Brian and I create, we often look for the never before, never again. Translate that. Can there be a never before, never again that you could offer? The second thing is that it's a beautiful time to tell a person, I don't need you to visit 20 of my locations. I'll give you a virtual experience of 20 of them and see the view of the race course from this one. And please see the view of the sea from the other. And, you know, please enjoy it. And this is so. If you offer them a great deal and a virtual reality experience, I think that's one thing that's possible. You could always engage with the sales channel to say, let me teach you how to sell better in this time. And that would be a great experience. So these are simple ideas. The other gentleman who talked about COVID, Brian, do you want to take that? About
how do you make an event more COVID compliant?
So, I mean, so for instance, I'll just give you an example of what we are doing. And it's yet another, you know, area of being prepared enough for when it does turn around. You know, we, again, like I said, like we need to understand what the brand requires to get done. We need to understand what the consumer requires to get done for things to reach normalcy. Obviously, everyone, including me, will be very concerned, are very concerned, will be very concerned about, as a consumer, about events going forward because of, you know, the obvious in COVID-19. Are we spending enough time understanding what are the measures we need to take? I know people who are developing apps that, you know, are self-distancing apps. I mean, if someone comes within 5 to 6 feet of you, it beeps. So it tells you that, you know, someone's too close to you or you are too close to someone.
Prepared for beeps everywhere.
Yes, yes. We used beeps to disguise other things in the past, but we'll need beeps now to warn us of things or areas that we're going wrong in. But we need to be researching. I've just had a conversation and a mail exchange. When I say I mean the company with companies that are actually doing this professionally. They're actually creating safety measures or parameters that govern safety measures and what will be required to use those parameters effectively. They're actually doing it. There are companies doing it. So we need to be thinking about it because I'm a hopeful person, like I said. And when things turn around, whenever that is, I would need to be compliant, not just to what the brand needs, but to what the consumer or the person attending that event needs. So there are companies, to answer your question very directly, there are companies who are looking at that. Look it up and you'll find more than a couple of good companies that are actually creating, and this is where collaboration comes in. Companies that are creating methodology and actual products that will help you stay COVID compliant or safety compliant. Take a look at it.
Thank you, Brian. And you know, I want to at this point bring, I want to say that we share your optimism about the country, about the economy, about brands, businesses, that they will reinvent. As Roshan said, you got to reimagine your business. We at Exchange for Media certainly believe that. And 20 days back, we launched Red Carpet. Exchange for Media does not have a experiential marketing IP. And we believe that, you know, Exchange for Media should have one. So, Ruhel Amin has launched, and Tushar have launched Red Carpet. We launched it with 20-odd very large CMOs on the jury. We believe that the industry will be back. So we really share your optimism. I would say cautious optimism, because you got to look at costs. So I want to bring Ruhel Amin. Ruhel, all of you know, is our experiential editor for Exchange for Media. He's a senior editor, does fantastic jobs. We've survived him for 8 years. You know, I have survived him for 8 years. So Ruhel, go ahead, ask your question.
Mr. Abbas and Mr. Tellis, lovely hearing you.
Can we get this gentleman on the screen? I hope.
Okay.
Yes.
Hello. Great listening to you. I was, in fact, tweeting, I mean, what all you said. So, quick question I have. Roshan, you said that you created an event with 7,000 people online.
Yeah.
Just want to say, how was this? I mean, did it create the impact that you looked at? Is it really kind of doable as we move on from here?
So the beauty of it was that this is what I keep saying, that you can create a passive event where 7,000 people event and they exit. But the idea is, how do you make the event active? And I don't want to let any of my secrets out, but I can assure you that I have an entire team that sits and keeps only saying this, that how do you translate that human experience across a digital screen? That's it. You can make it equally interesting if the prime minister of this country can get everyone to go to their balcony and, you know, clank a thali, I can get 7,000 people to take an action together as well.
So you said this is a lab in COVID times that we are living in. My last question to Mr. Tellis. So, I mean, do we see phygital coming up in a very big way?
Sorry, I lost you. Ruel, I lost you.
Phygital, physical, digital.
Do we see phygital coming up in a very big way?
No, absolutely right. I said it on the top of the discussion, Ruel, and I'm reinforcing it now. I think over the years, and I don't want to waste time giving examples, challenges have to be hurdles that help us redefine ourselves and actually grow. Okay. And I believe that this challenge, this particular challenge, I don't need to tell anyone to convince them, has given a huge relevance and importance to digital in what was on ground physical. Okay. I believe that we'd be fools not to accept it wholeheartedly with open arms. I know there's a theory that says don't go to digital because, you know, it will eat into our otherwise profit of physical. You know, if we were earning 60 rupees from physical, we're earning 6 rupees from digital. These are all short-term manifestations of what the end result can be. To come back to your question, I have an emphatic yes to say that phygital is the way to go. It's the balance between physical and digital that will actually define effectiveness in what we do. One will not replace the other. I said it in the beginning, it will be the balance between physical and digital that will determine effectiveness. And effectiveness obviously will determine quantity of work and earnings. So you have to be prudent, and there's no ready answer. It's based on who you are, your strengths. It's based on the client you're talking about, or the brand you're talking about. It's based on the consumer and the mindset, the kind of consumer you're talking about, the type, you know, the demographic type or psychographic type of consumer you're talking about. So those are all subjective answers or subjective answers to subjective questions. Broadly speaking, it's the time for phygital. Drawing the balance between physical and digital will be the ask.
And Tushar Diwan, who runs Red Carpet, that's the name of the E4M experiential IP, Red Carpet. Tushar wants to ask a question. Tushar, go ahead. Priyanka, can we get Tushar on the screen? So again, one clean shaven guy and one guy who hasn't shaved. Tushar, you can Tushar. Ask the question.
Yeah.
Hi. Hey, Tushar. Thanks for your insights. Everybody right now is talking about digital and how do we do events. But nobody is talking about people like MCs, anchors, event agencies, and vendors who in general, like a sound guy or a stage setup guy, who doesn't know how to function digitally or is not well versed with the digital platforms. So what?
And what should MCs do? Some of them doing web. Kathy did one today. Yesterday, Sanchali was there. I'm sure other MCs are doing online events. They're reinventing their persona. What business are we in? I think, Roshan, you said. So, smaller, mid-sized agencies? Yeah. There are lots of questions like that also. What do we do to survive?
So, let's divide it into the talent, and then let's divide it into, on the other side, let's vendors. Look at the people who are providing you support services, technical services, etc. Technical services, many technical services will find online avatars. For example, when you do a sound concert online, currently Zoom is not optimized for concerts. Somebody will find the solution, and that solution will be worth $1 million. Anybody who can reduce quality of HD across lower bandwidth, millions of dollars of money to be made. anybody who can actually hold a website, hold a webinar to tell us how to look better in limited light at home, millions of dollars to be made. Anybody who can tell, who can be a Zoom certified MC. I can tell you, like, I promise you, I've been doing this for 2 months now. I know how to run this. Like, I mean, I genuinely, like, I love doing it. I can switch to this.
You know, by the way, Roshan, I have to tell you that you're the only speaker, and I'm doing three webinars with very big guys who actually got the questions, who's looking at the screen.
No, I am looking at, I am, Anurag, even looking at the number of participants drop at which point I take screenshots of things. This is a joy for a person who loves technology. And a Zoom certified MC will be the highest paid MC in the future. Because they will be able to control an offline, online experience together. If Khyati tomorrow picks that up, she's going to kick ass with all of this. Because that's what you need to do. I'm able to integrate music. Many people are not, because I learned something which others don't know. I keep saying knowledge is power. My parents are both teachers. They always taught me this thing, saying knowledge is power. And that's it. You just need to find...
And that's the red carpet jury. It's not the full. We have now 28 jury members. This is a very old one. Tushar and Ruel have done a fantastic job. Of course, some of our editors are there. Noor, Nazia.
I saw Noor and I was most happy. Noor should win an award for the best hairstyle after Anurag.
So, if I may chip in, Dr. Batra, just because we're talking about MCs and Roshan sir has been telling us about it. So, there was a question on Facebook Live as well from Shalini Shankar sir, which said that most of the artists and performing artists are taking a hit right now because whatever we can possibly do physically, there is still a limitation on what we could do digitally. So are there anything, suggestions or tips that you can share with us? And also on the revenue, monetizing this, because a lot of people are doing certain things, but are doing it in a non-commercial way currently. So how do we monetize?
I promise you, I have made more money as a host online post-COVID than I made in the 2 months pre-COVID. And I assure you, it's amazing. Because again, I went and sold something unique. I said, guys, I can assure you I'll create more engagement online than offline by doing the following things. One, and there was a whole list of things that I could list. B, I was able to turn and say that there is a tech that you can integrate in this tech. So not just this tech, there are other techs. So number one, I'm saying, don't think revenue opportunities are over. There are enough revenue opportunities. There is a price drop. That is a natural thing. But I'm very happy to do a price drop because from here, I go into my shorts and go into the next room. I don't have to travel, stay, live, be away from my children. I can go and, you know, hug my daughter and come back and do the next section. It's perfect. So we should pay that much as a dearness cost that we should all come down with. That's fine.
Right.
When people are asking you to do too many things free, that too you got to weigh as an opportunity, saying how much publicity, how much relevance, how much engagement. Do I get a point to turn and say I'm available at? I mean, you've got to also, we often get exploited as talent.
Yeah.
So I think that there are opportunities. The talent that discovers how to engage people on screen will keep winning the battle.
Fantastic. On this note, I think we have to keep to our time. I just want to ask you one question. And the question is, can you sing a song for us? Or a couple that gives hope? How can you give a, you know, you both Brian. Are performers. You're not, you know, you're, as I said, multifaceted, multi-talented in the real sense of it. And I really mean it. And I really respect you guys. And
go for it, Roshan. I'll back you up on how many.
Okay. Here's a little song I wrote. You might want to sing it note for note. Don't worry.
Be happy.
Be happy. Oh, if you worry, your face will frown. That'll bring everybody down. So don't worry. Be no one now. Be happy.
Beautiful. That's beautiful. And Brian?
You never heard me singing the harmonies I sang.
Not like this one.
Okay, with all the business potential that Roshan has, if only he wore a skirt, I'd have proposed to him.
I know that Brian and I are a marriage made in heaven. It didn't happen.
But Roshan, if you wore a skirt and if you looked a lot prettier, then you do look like Shaheen does. I'd have sung to you, stuck on you.
Ooh.
I got this feeling down deep in my soul that I just can't be. Yes, I'm on my way. I'm mighty glad.
There you go. Thank you so much. Thank you, Roshan. Thank you, Brian, for making this Friday afternoon so much fun and
Thank
so
you.
Much real and giving very real advice God bless you. Continue to do well. And I must tell our viewers and readers that as the business comes back, as we all reinvent our business, as we redefine our businesses, we'll find new ideas, new solutions, and we at Exchange for Media will make sure we're a catalyst in that. Thank you. God bless you.
Thank you so much. Thank you, Ruhel. Thank you, Kathy. Thank you, Neeraj, Tushar, everyone, Priyanka.
Thank you, Kathy, Ruhel.
Thank you.
Thank you, Anurag. Thanks, Roshan.
Thank you, everyone. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you so much, Mr. Chalice and Mr. Abbas and Dr. Batra. Thank you for being here and making this session so interactive and so engaging and so entertaining too. Thank you so very much.